Hi, and welcome to another Ignite webcast. And my name is Josh Topal, and I'm a program manager for Office 365. So if this is your first time, let me tell you real quick that Ignite events are a series of technical workshops for IT professionals and Microsoft partners and really anyone else that's interested. And the Ignite webcasts will address different technical subjects and scenarios that are really beneficial to anyone who wants to increase their knowledge of the Office 365 suite. So today, again, we're really excited to have back Mark Cashman, who's going to lead us on this call. And Mark is a senior product manager on the SharePoint team, and he focuses primarily on SharePoint Online and SharePoint Mobility. He's also worked at Microsoft since 2000, so he's very knowledgeable and one of the veterans. So today's webcast, Mark will dive into SharePoint Online administration. So, you know, this session, again, provides a really good opportunity to hear directly from a Microsoft employee and learn some of the really cool new features that are coming for Office 365 and that are here. So today's webcast will be about an hour, and we'll leave a few minutes at the end to field questions from anyone on the call. So you can go ahead and at the end of the call, type the questions into the link chat box. We'll try to get to them if you type during the call, but I can't guarantee anything because Mark's going to be mostly focusing on this presentation. So we are recording today's session, and we'll have the slideshow presentation and the video available online on the original Ignite blog posts and on the Ignite website, and I'll paste those links for you in just a second. So one last thing is that since we are recording today's session, please understand that you may be captured in the recording. So if you don't wish to be captured, please do not type in the IM window, or if you want to just be extra safe, feel free to leave the meeting and catch it, the video recording, at a later time. So that's it for me, and here are the blog posts that you can go check out all of our stuff. But Mark, whenever you're ready, we can go ahead.
Thanks, Josh. And thank you everybody for joining. I know that sometimes morning in the Pacific time zone is morning, but certainly if you're joining us from the afternoon, the evening, or way out of whack in terms of your own time zone, and if your eyes are half closed, thank you for joining us. It is going to be a pretty packed hour talking about SharePoint Online administration. We're going to be looking at the UI, you know, from the Office 365 admin layer real quick into the SharePoint Online admin UI, just so if you haven't seen the new look and feel, or just certainly a look at what some of the new components are, we'll go there. And then we'll dive into where there's almost no UI. If you've ever used PowerShell, you'll know what I mean. But we'll be walking through a lot of the cool things you can do with PowerShell now. And primarily, it's about 70% demo and 30% slides or Q&A when we get to a little bit towards the end. Certainly, if you've got questions about specific sections or a specific question that pops up, don't hesitate to put it into the IM window immediately. But certainly, we'll try to get to those for sure by the end. I'll try to get all of them from a verbal perspective so I can speak to them. But if you hang out and I haven't addressed it verbally, just so that we don't bleed over from a lot of time, I'll certainly be able to address them in a written way so that you make sure to get your answer. And you don't actually need to stay on for the whole thing if you've asked a question, because we'll certainly provide it and you can check it later when you do have time. So like Josh said, I'm on the SharePoint team. I'm a senior product manager, and I've been focusing online for a little while, a little over 3 years now. And I'm also going to be putting in a lot of resources just for my Twitter account. You don't need to follow me, but if you just check it today, you'll see a lot of new resources being pumped out there using the hashtag SPOAdmin. That's SPOAdmin. And you'll see those by the end of the hour. There's a bunch of them. So let's get started and really just spend a couple of minutes on looking at quick definition of what does it mean to be an admin. And first, really, to look historically at where we've started and certainly to then move into where we're going and where we are. But if you're working and have been an admin on premises, you're certainly doing a lot of things that you don't do in the cloud. But certainly you're at a different level of administration for SharePoint. That would be the farm level or central administrator. And you're doing a lot of things in terms of managing the actual bare metal, managing the updates, the patches, certainly the uptime, reliability, backup, restore. You're taking those, you know, a lot of those types of calls. So you might have a lot of focus on recovering from different failures, working on capacity planning if your company is growing or the needs of SharePoint are growing. And then certainly you're also focused on the customization of SharePoint specific to your business requirements. And a lot of that will first start with who can access the sites, who can have the right level of permissions, and how that varies across your different SharePoint sites, document libraries, company portals, extranets, public websites, you name it. There's a lot of things that you certainly will manage from the making it look and feel and work the way that you want it to. But certainly there's that first aspect of standing the server up and managing it so that it's accessible. This is just a real quick look at what an on-premises admin would do. And certainly a lot of feedback we're getting is this is, of course, the kind of the bread and butter of where a SharePoint admin has lived for some time. And the next slide really articulates either what's being added to their tool belt or what is maybe a very different person or different role, which is the cloud admin. So the cloud admin really doesn't do any of those first activities. You know, they're not managing when is the next cumulative update coming out, what's in the next service pack, what does that mean in terms of the time that I need to spend to get that into production, certainly tested and approved. But they're also not worried about uptime and the backup restore and some of those things that can be very costly or very time consuming. And to be honest, one of those things that then becomes what their job is. The cloud admin, and certainly does not need to be a single person by any means, but it may be for smaller companies or it may be for various departments who are managing different levels of their cloud investment. But here, the focus really is that business, those business requirements, building out or configuring real simple solutions based on out-of-the-box technology, or working with developers to onboard new apps and solutions, you know, for different parts of the company, different business group units, but really also just articulating different zones that these different business units can come into. And I can, I'll kind of articulate a couple of those scenarios when we start to kind of actually build out different site collections and manage permissions and all that. But all the same thing comes to play. Like the end result is your company using SharePoint and using it the way that they want and to get the value out of it, but also backed with the management and control that IT expects and certainly requires from a privacy and security perspective. So again, the on-premises may have these as new things that they do and learning in terms of what can I do in the cloud and what can't I do. But for a new admin, it may be this is what is afforded to me, hopefully with the concept of not having to worry about so much of just standing the server up and keeping it humming, but certainly then just pushing the value. So this is our quick definition of the difference between on-prem and cloud admin. To go one step further into what does that mean then for SharePoint, and this is specifically SharePoint Online within Office 365, these are the four main zones that an admin would focus on if they've made investments in the suite level of Office 365. And I'll show a little bit mostly from Office 365, that top blue box, and certainly show a lot from the SharePoint level. But at a real high level, the Office 365 admin console is where you're going to go to manage your users, to connect to Active Directory, manage your licenses, whether you want to sign them or hold them for people who are going to be onboarding soon, and then certainly to apply your domains if you're going to have any vanity domains for email or vanity domains for the SharePoint Online public website. But specific to SharePoint, we're starting to manage things like SkyDrive Pro. We're managing certainly sites at a real broad level and sometimes just a singular site depending on what plan you've invested in. But we also have the focus of managing apps and course managing profiles either coming from Active Directory or just at the SharePoint level. So I'll dive even more deeply as we get into demo, but this should just be a pretty broad, easy look at what type of things am I actually managing or can have access to manage when I'm looking at Office 365. And it's a real high broad level look here, but to be honest, it's a real deep granular access to a lot of the business requirements that we see that people have requested for. And over time, you've been able to do more and more management and control in Office 365. And that's even more, that's very, very true for SharePoint compared to our previous two releases in BPOS previously, and certainly V1 of Office 365, and where we're at now, we just call it the new Office 365 or the new SharePoint Online, but really is V2 of Office 365. So I'm just making sure everybody can hear. It looks like some folks are having just a little bit of trouble signing in, signing out, but it doesn't seem to be too overwhelming. So I will make some assumptions that we're doing okay with audio. And really what I'm going to transition to now is a lot of demo. And then hopefully you'll be able to do the demo yourself, and I'll share a resource with you after the demo that really covers almost everything that I'm walking through. If you want to try it yourself, or you want to use it as something to reference back to. And I'll explain a little bit more about what I'm publishing today, and then certainly what the team's doing to make it a little bit more more of an offering that's long-term, obviously managed by TechNet and Office.com. But I've got a document that I think will be pretty fun to review, if even just to see what did he do. And you'll see that it's very much at a level of your learning PowerShell or your learning SharePoint Online Admin. It's not the it's not taking the assumption that you are a deep subject matter expert already, and hopefully that will be useful. But what we're going to do is we're going to look at the new UI, and I'm going to start one level up because it's helpful to kind of see how you get from one to the other and what they mean and what you do there. So I will start in the Office 365 Admin Center, go to the SharePoint Online Admin Center, and then spend a significant amount of time in PowerShell, but really walking through various scenarios of what a cloud admin or a SharePoint Online admin would do and can do. And then hopefully, as fun as PowerShell can be, and hopefully you'll join me in seeing that it's pretty fun, especially if you've never done it, it's sort of like, wow, I didn't know I could do that. It's pretty powerful, and hopefully I've cherry-picked a couple of fun scenarios to land on. So with that, I'm going to switch over, and I'll just get a little kind of verbal or visual confirmation from Josh to make sure that you're able to see what's going on here. And I just need to minimize that. You should see some seals. And then we're going to start here. So the first thing I have loaded up here, and I'll take 2 seconds. Josh, if you wouldn't mind, just in the IM chat that we have, just let me know that you're able to see this.
Center.
You can see it?
Yeah, the admin center.
Okay, great.
Perfect, thanks.
So this is Office 365 Admin Center. This is certainly the new look and feel. And there have been a lot of additions since we've launched. If you last looked at this in February when we came out of preview, or if you played with it during preview before that, the new look and feel certainly is a lot cleaner, and there's a lot of access and a lot of information that we're putting forth here. So the first thing you see, and it's one of those, unfortunately, on the day that I'm giving a presentation, SharePoint is yellow. But we believe in full transparency. That's really the goal that we're having here. I'm going to actually go into to show you one of the errors that we're having with SharePoint right now. It's not a significant one for production, but it's impacting some of the upgrade activities. But it'll give you a good instance of what is real information. This is a demo tenant that I'm in, but I'm getting real information about the production service because certainly I'm on production in my demo tenant. So if I go into this, I'll get a kind of a brief what's going on with SharePoint. If I hover over it, you'll see that I get kind of the full breadth of what's going on. And right now we're in the process of upgrading a number of customers from the SharePoint 2010 look and feel to the 2013 look and feel. And this particular issue, which we're working on clearing as fast as we can, is just impacting some of those upgrade activities. I'm going to drill in, not necessarily because I want to harbor on this particular issue, but I just want to show you the level of detail that you can get and can expect. Certainly here's the full layout of when it started, and actually always we're posting when we're going to be providing more information. And this is not to limit you from opening up a service request or submitting or calling to support, but hopefully it gives you that insight that you've been looking for. When I click back, it actually takes us to a zone that's really super helpful. If you've not seen this, this is the service health dashboard, and you're seeing a lot more than SharePoint here, and that should be pretty apparent with the way it's bucketed. But here's Exchange Online. I'm going to collapse it just so we can at some point only see SharePoint. But you'll notice here the SharePoint Online service currently is now split up between these main services. Tenant Admin is what I'm going to show a lot of next, just to give you a sense of what we're looking at here. But you'll see right here, provisioning is where we saw this error. And if I were to click into that, it would take me to that same error. So I can get to this by going on the left-hand side. You'll see where it says service health. And this is something that we're focusing a lot on in terms of making it more real-time, more granular, and certainly very open to feedback and hopefully just raising visibility to it so you can see what's going on here. But fortunately, everything else is very green except for provisioning, but certainly that's what people come here for. Some of the other things that I'm just going to highlight real quickly and then move on is if you're setting up for the first time, we do have some quick start wizards for some simple configurations up to things that are more complex where you're actually syncing Active Directory or maybe migrating email and actually configuring hybrid environments. And for SharePoint, that's pretty important for an admin to review if you're doing that. And I've got a resource later that points to some of our deeper hybrid documentation. The last thing that I'm going to go to is just the service settings. And you'll see that this is broken up again by Exchange Online or managing your mail, your sites, managing SharePoint Online, Link, and all the way down. And there's a lot to cover here, which we have had in previous sessions, and there's a lot of information on. But if I start to navigate into sites, again, from an Office 365 level, I can do one thing for SharePoint Online from here pretty easily. I can go in and create a new site collection. And I'm not going to do it here, but when I click onto it and it were to open up the same dialog box that I will do from SharePoint Online Admin, you'll see that it's the same action. It's just taking you from here to there. And so we're trying to integrate the experience, and we're certainly trying to up-level what needs to be here. And this is an area that we're exploring a lot to simplify the what you need to do from a broad level and what you need to do when you navigate into SharePoint Online. But if you want to get to SharePoint Online Admin, which is what I'm going to go to next, there's two ways to get there. I can come here and click this link, which will take me to the SharePoint Admin Center. But if you'll notice, I'm logged in as an admin, and I'm logged in as an admin with a lot of permissions to be able to admin at the Office 365 layer, which is where we're at. And then if I wanted to, I could navigate into Exchange, Link, and SharePoint, which would be the same if I clicked in here to get to the SharePoint Online Admin Center. So I'm going to do it from here, just so you can see that the top navigation is consistent. And now I'm moving from Office 365 Admin Center to the SharePoint Online Admin Center with hopefully that consistent look and feel. So it's not jarring. It's in the same browser window. It's not a pop-up. And certainly it's a cleaner approach in terms of if you've not seen Office 365 recently, but certainly even compared to Office 365 V1, it's a lot cleaner and hopefully a lot more information that's bubbled up. The very first screen that you land on is the Site Collections Administration. And just to walk you through here to familiarize with what you're seeing here, some of these site collections are created for you by Microsoft when we first provision your tenancy. And those are site collections or web zones that you need specifically to use it on day one. So one of those instances is the personal sites site collection, what we call the My Site Root. And that's something that just then articulates kind of the look and feel for all of your users or employees' personal sites. And certainly that is where SkyDrive Pro lives in terms of the experience. You'll see I've generated a whole bunch of unique site collections and name them different things, and I'll walk through a couple, and we're going to generate a lot more, so we'll get a lot more comfortable there. The one up here that's isolated in terms of a website is actually our public site collection. And to manage this is a little bit different because a lot of the work you do here is to actually do the design work. So maybe one of the admin activities here is you invite an external designer, somebody who doesn't work for your company, and you can invite them as an external user to this particular site collection, and then they can do all of the design work on your behalf. And when you're done with that project or you're done with the access that they need, you can then remove them and you're back to just your company accessing that. But everything else on the right here is just to identify the amount of resources you've allocated to those site collections, and you can dynamically add more, and I'll show that in just one second. And you can certainly take away the storage quota. And you can do that for resources, which means if you're having custom solutions that are running on SharePoint, that you would allocate those. If you have it as zero, means you don't want custom solutions. And that might be a real explicit choice from the admin. This is a generic team site. We don't want anybody spending time or money on a custom solution. This is not an app, but a custom solution running on SharePoint. So you can level it zero, and those local solutions won't work. And then we certainly identify the version you're on. This will probably go away soon because soon everybody will be on the 2013 experience or the new SharePoint Online, and that will go away. But let me actually start to do some things manually, and then I'm going to do things through PowerShell as well. So you can see how we can do it either through PowerShell or certainly in bulk through PowerShell with a lot of other little bells and whistles. So I'm going to go into just one of these that I already have existing, and I'm going to do a few things. I'm going to add a new owner. So this is now somebody, if I wanted to give them site collection admin control. I'm going to give Katie J, who is my demo colleague here, I'm going to type her in as a site collection administrator. It'll resolve her name, and when I hit OK, she'll now have full control of that site collection. You'll notice there can only be one primary, but as a secondary, Katie J would have as much access to manage that particular site collection, but it does not give her permissions to come to this SharePoint Online Admin Center to do anything else, to work with another site collection, to add, you know, or take away from the term store or other activities. It's just giving her access to this one particular site collection. And so that's how you manage manually add somebody as a higher permissioned SharePoint site collection owner. The other things we're going to do here, I'm going to pick another one while that's spinning around a little bit to projects. And I'm going to adjust the sharing that's going on here. Right now, the sharing is set to do not share. And one thing that I won't spend a whole lot of time on because I had another session where we walked through sharing end to end, and I can certainly answer any questions. But really, I've made an explicit choice that at my company, I do want to share. I do want to share externally. But when I make that first choice, I'm not actually sharing anything at the site collection level. I've just explicitly said, I'm okay, or my organization has run through our policies, and we do want to share externally, but not everything, and certainly nothing from that day one. On day two, when you actually get different business teams or business units or different people wanting to have a zone where they can do extranet type activities, this is what you would do, and you would go and do it per site collection, and you can turn it on for all or none or some. It really is that granular control. So if I go in here and click the second radio button, what I'm effectively telling SharePoint is I want to share externally, but I do want people to have to sign in to be a known entity so I can control their permissions. I can limit what they can do, but certainly just to know who they are and who did what. If I want to have that next level of sharing, I can still invite people in an authenticated way, but I also have a new feature and where I can invite people anonymously to a single document, what we call guest links. So this doesn't mean that you have everybody now invited anonymously. It just means at a document level, you can now additionally invite people either to sign in to this specific document or to share it with them anonymously. And at the very end of the presentation, I've got two guest links that I've generated to share out both the manual that I talked about that walks through the lab and also the presentation itself, and I'll be tweeting those a little bit later. But I'm doing that using a guest link. So I manage the content in SharePoint, but people access that link. As an admin, this is where I'm going to say, yes, I've approved that this team or people using this zone of my SharePoint can do these activities. If I don't want any anonymous sharing, I go here. And if I want no sharing whatsoever, it's a very internal, secure, private zone, I certainly would never turn on this feature. But I'll turn on the middle zone just so you can see what it looks like when I click save. SharePoint's going to go in and adjust a few things on just that site collection. You're going to get the fun Ferris wheel here of the nighttime glowing green, and that will soon be adjusted. And within a couple of clicks and a couple of minutes, we now have an extranet zone, which I've got turned on a few of them here. The last thing that I'm going to show you from a manual perspective is I'm actually going to add a little bit of storage to this site collection, which you're going to see me do a few things to, both from my Mark demo persona, and then what does that look like for a non-admin user as I'm giving her more and more permissions. And that's, again, working with my demo partner, Katie J. But I'm going to go in here, and I'm going to add more storage. So this is going to open up a simple dialog box that says, well, how much more storage do you want? And I'm going to kind of hover this over to the right here. Hopefully that doesn't get too much off your screens. But you'll notice up here just above, it's grayed out because it's behind this pop-up, but it's telling me how much storage I have available. And for any action as an admin, if I don't have enough to give, I can do two things, or I can really do three things. I may need to delete content that's in a recycle bin. I may ask people to archive or remove content that's old and out of date. But certainly that's more of an activity just from a compliance or an audit perspective if you have older content. I can also just take some storage away that's not being used by other site collections, and I can easily run a report with PowerShell to see that, or I can also just quickly see here, it looks like I've got 100 or 1,000. Let me go in and look to see how much of that 1,000 they're using, and I can reallocate it. And if you're maxed out with the storage that you have available, you can always go buy more. And once you've bought more, this number will grow, and then you can apply it to the site collections as you wish. So we're going to go in here, and we're going to really jack up them from 100 to 1,000. And I've noticed that this team has been using a lot of storage, and at 85%, they always call me and ask me to up it. So if I want to get ahead of the game and get them before they call me, I'll be notified now when it's 75% full, and I can go in here and add a little bit more proactively and have that as a work stream for something where I'm helping more proactively give my users what they need, when they need it, or even before they need it. So this little change again is gonna open up us to go to the fairgrounds again with the spinning wheel, and is gonna apply now 900 more megabytes to that particular site collection. And there's everybody on the Ferris wheel spinning with the ants and having fun. But those are effectively what I wanted to show you from a very manual perspective. I'm going to do a little drill down just in terms of what are all of these other settings and just drill into a few of them and then certainly spend the rest of really the next half hour doing PowerShell. So if I go in here, one of the other things that is helpful, even if just to do a little bit of self-learning for things that you do learn today or maybe want to refer back to, is we've got a little bit more granular information. If I do a hover and you're curious, what is BCS? We've got now little pop-ups that actually tell you what it is, what you would use it for. It doesn't necessarily take you to the help or how-to content, but that's always a click away on office.com. But my favorite call-out is the one that we have for one of our newest features, which is for apps. So if you want to hover over apps and find out more what that's all about, here we go. You manage SharePoint apps. So I want to push a little feedback to the team that we would like to maybe explain this one. But you get the point. There's a little bit more information hidden underneath. And if I navigate through, the InfoPath is really where you go. And if you are purchasing the ability to use InfoPath, this is where you go to enable it so your end users can use InfoPath, which are really more dynamic, higher-end forms that you can use in SharePoint to collect information or to really put a lot of business process behind in terms of people filling out forms at different points in a business process. User profiles is an area where you can actually do a lot, and I'll show you two things here. This is where if I wanted to, as I'm starting to map either from Active Directory or I just want to map from Office 365 Active Directory or what is just effectively your authentication provider, if I go into Manage User Properties, this is where I'm going to actually define what are my managed properties. And you can see we've got a number of them out of the box here. And really the first or primary thing that you would do here is you could manage the who has access to change this, whether it's something that only admins can do, something only that you can take in here where you can see that it's a mapped attribute. But it also could be where you could go in and say, you know what, for people to identify their own peers, this might be one of those things where we actually want to make it so that they can input their own information. So make this more of a free form, something that the end user could fill out. But certainly when you start to get to job titles and departments, work phone, those types of informations, data fields, those are things you maybe already have stored in Active Directory and you don't want the end user to be able to change some of those things. So you can lock those down so that at least at the SharePoint level, they couldn't go in and make the change themselves. You would have to do it on their behalf. Which is really the second thing I wanted to show. If I actually want to go in and manage an individual's user profile, I'm going to go into my, again, demo mate, KDJ. And you'll see down here, if I hover over and then click down to edit her profile, you'll see all those fields we just talked about. This is now going to show all of her real information. And I could go in here and I could put in some freeform text on her behalf. Certainly, if I wanted to let everybody know that she is a subject matter expert in, let's see, something that she's not, we'll put in sales analysis. I can put that in here. And how this is reflected on her personal site, I'll show when we transition over to her. But effectively, it gives everybody kind of a cheat quick to reach out to her, to find her as a sales analysis expert, and even to start a dialogue with that as the subject already for her in SharePoint. So if I do that on her behalf, I'm going to save and close, and now she's got a new skill that people will be able to discover her more quickly. So if I navigate through BCS and what we call the secure store, are kind of another level above really what you would do on day one. But this is where if you're connecting to backend systems, you would use BCS to do that translation layer between SharePoint Online and your backend system. That might be a CRM system or an ERP system, where you're really building the logic that is that translation layer in between the front end for your users, which could be most likely in this case for sure is SharePoint Online, and then maybe your backend data source, which could be SQL, it could be Oracle, it could be something as complex as CRM, SAP, and whatnot. An area just that's kind of visual, it's pretty easy to see that you can affect at the tenant level. And then you can also do this per site collection level is the term store. And the term store is effectively the way you describe your content or your information. And in the term store, you can upload your own term sets. And you'll see here where we've got a term set that's already applied for Contoso research. And you'll see that we've got these different terms that are listed and layered. If you go into the HR group, you can see things that they've listed and layered here in terms of ways of tagging and applying content. All the way down to things, if people started to do free-form taxonomies, you would see that show up here. It seems like, oh, a lot of people are tagging our content with purple couch. So I could see that and go, well, we call purple couch magenta, so we're going to stick with the corporate taxonomy. But if it looks like a lot of people are using purple instead of magenta and you want it to effectively mean the same thing, you can up-level that to a managed term and have that applied and used or referenced so that they both mean the same thing, or now people can see that from the picker when they're tagging their content. So if I navigate down through the records management, this is where you could go to configure what we call send to activities. So if I've got a workflow process or a manual process that I want to kick off, when somebody declares something more of a record, I could send it to a record center that you would have set up in SharePoint Online. And that would just deem something that's from a lifecycle management perspective, a send to thread that would send it to the record center that you set up here, and you program it here by creating the destination and then pointing to it. And then from the business solutions or from a manual click, people could click on the piece of content and then have it send to that record center, which then could do a whole lot of things from apply policies, apply information rights management, do a whole bunch of stuff that then notifies other people that a record has been established. And those are pretty powerful business solutions, certainly, that then have different tasks for admins to do. I'm going to jump into search real quickly, but you can see here there's a whole lot that you can do on search, and we've got a ton of information about how you can control how people search, what the search results look like, how you map different search terms that people might use to mean certain things that you've structured. And there's a whole lot of real powerful stuff you can do with search. It's very much an admin activity based on business requirements that you go in here and program SharePoint to work and feel, look and feel exactly how you want it to. And we've got some things that we're working on here to even give the admins more control of how you can generate dynamic pages driven by just search. And so look for some of those things in a couple of months to close to the end of the year. There'll be some great additions to SharePoint Online. The last two areas I'm going to spend, and I'm just going to click two more clicks, and then we'll move into PowerShell, is from an apps perspective. This is where you go to purchase apps, to sideload apps that you have written as a company, and you're putting them into SharePoint, potentially connecting them through Azure in terms of where they run from. It could also be run from an Amazon Web Services zone, or it could be from an app server on-prem or something you manage in a DMZ zone. You can certainly do that, and this is where you go to manage that. But it's pretty straightforward in terms of navigating to your app catalog, going to purchase apps, which is what I'm going to show you real briefly, but managing licenses that you've bought, configuring a lot of the sessions, and even managing the permissions that people have to different apps as you purchase them or build them to limit the who can use those solutions. But if we go into purchase apps, from a unified experience, as much as we can, I need to choose my language here, so we'll go with something that I can read, but you can see that we've got a number of languages we support in the store. But if I choose on English, you'll see here that I'm still in the context of my tenant. So if you can see this URL up here, I'm still in the context of my SharePoint Online tenant, but I've now navigated to the SharePoint store, which is live. This is not demo. This is a live environment. And you'll see things that we're promoting here as featured apps. If you're familiar with companies like AvePoint, Nintex, there's even some HP solutions that are now in here. And of course, there's some smaller development shops that are starting to put some things that are just some kind of fun little simple web parts up to very complex solutions. And even this company, Point 8020, is putting out solutions and the source code so that you could go and even more refine what the solutions they're building. And I think they've got 4 apps in there. But anyway, it's a zone where you can go and get existing solutions. You could certainly publish your own if you're a development shop. But from an admin or a company perspective, this is where you would go to get the apps. And once you have them, then certainly you then can apply them to a specific site collection or to more company-wide at the tenant level. Last stop on the UI here in the SharePoint Online Admin Center is effectively where you go and you do a lot of very powerful things in terms of how you're shaping SharePoint for your business requirements or some of the things you don't want to allow, or certainly some of the things that you do want to allow. One of the biggest things we announced a couple weeks ago, maybe not a couple months ago, is the Yammer service is now available. And you'll see in my demo tenant, I'm still using the news feed. But here at Microsoft, we switched over to Yammer in the cloud. So if I'm on my real environment to going to either a Yammer or SkyDrive Pro, I would actually see that this is now says Yammer. And that's all because of this button as an admin. I'm not going to commit to it here. But if I wanted to, I could commit to Yammer, start to configure that, and now I'm using Yammer. And you would see it reflected here in the top navigation as well as that choice. This is that parent button that I talked about for external sharing, where I can go and turn on various levels of external sharing. You'll see that I've set it so that it's given me full access to give both authenticated sharing at the site level or document level, and of course anonymous sharing at the doc level, what we call guest links. Some of the things that I'll want to point out here, if you want to configure information rights for Office for SharePoint Online document libraries, you do have one task, and this will walk you through it from a help perspective, but you would first turn on IRM at the Office 365 layer because it's a service that can be consumed by Exchange and SharePoint. Then when you want to activate it for SharePoint Online, you go here and you use it. It'll know whether it's been set up yet or not in Office 365. If it hasn't, it'll remind you. But if I go in here and say, yes, I want to use IRM, I would click this radio button, refresh the settings, and I've got one last action, which is to go to a document library and actually turn it on at the document level, library level. Certainly, it's not one of those features you want to turn on for your entire tenancy or all of your SharePoint sites. You can if you want, but it's managed at that granular document library level. And typically, it might be more around a record center or a document center where you've got more of your lockdown, private, final type documents that you want to control, who has permissions, not to access them, but to even open them. This is what you use IRM for. And then the last thing here is for end users, if you want to enable them to be able to create their own sites that they then manage, not a full site collection, but a full site, you can do that here. And it effectively gives them some new UI in their personal site to click and start to create and use their own site, which they can invite whomever they want to work and collaborate with. Maybe a specific project, maybe it's a stretch goal that they're working on and they want to have a site where they can park that. Documents and timelines and whatnot. This is enabling the end user to have that power. So that's a pretty quick look at the SharePoint Online Admin Center, which effectively is a lot of the UI that you have access to if you're an admin, and you certainly can delegate to a number of people in your company to be able to have access here, or certainly the Office 365 admin. But now we're going to take a lot of the admin UI away. And we're going to look at the seals real quick, and then I'm going to open up an instance that I already have going here, which is PowerShell. And this is in the specific mode, hopefully so you can see it a little bit better. But it is PowerShell like any other, then with our SharePoint Online Management Shell applied to it so that I then can have the controls to reach out to SharePoint Online. And one of the first things that I do here is first connect to the service. I'm going to pull in. And I've sort of got a little cheater screen that you can't see here just so you don't see me fumbling and typing. But I'll just copy and paste, and then I'll walk through what you see before I actually hit the return button. So here I'm going to first connect to the SharePoint Online service. This is my admin center. If you remember the URL that I pointed out, it's that same admin center URL. So if I took this and copy pasted it into an Internet Explorer or to Firefox, Safari, Chrome, this would take me to what you just saw. Then it's going to pass this credential, which is my admin credential, or a user that has admin privileges. And when I hit return, it's going to prompt me for my password. And then when I hit OK, I should get a prompt return that says I'm ready to go to the next thing. So I'm just going to start here and just familiarize with some of the new actions that we have available in PowerShell. And so I'm going to first navigate to just show you a couple of intro steps that just more show you kind of as a fun proof what actually is available to you in this environment. So first I'm going to ask, what are all of the different commandlets that are available for SharePoint Online? And I'll stretch this out a little bit so that we can see a little bit more. If you're already familiar with PowerShell, some of these will start to make sense, where I'm getting certain things from sites, or I'm creating new things, I'm deleting them, removing them, I'm restoring, and then certainly we've got a couple commandlets that are very specific to upgrade. And with the two that I'll point out here is, if you want to commit to upgrading a site collection from that 2010 look and feel to 2013, you can do it through PowerShell, or you can also get a evaluation site collection or a request one that would pass through a command that would then create a dummy site collection with all of your real data, but it's just a temporary to do your development and test in the new look and feel. And then when you're done with that, you would destroy that site collection. But this is where you could do through PowerShell. If you had 15 site collections that you would want to do your further testing on, you could create a very simple script that would go in and create evaluation site collections for all 15 site collections. You would then get the information of the location of that new site collection to do your testing on, and then you could go and you could remove those site collections when you're done with them, and then finally commit to the new 2013 look and feel. And we've got a whole set of documentation on how to do that, but just to give you a sense of what's out there. The other thing that I want to show you is, if you want to see what site collections you have in this environment, I'm going to pass through another command that is the get SPO site, and I'm adding this detailed term, and then actually formatting how I want that to look here in PowerShell. So this will give me a sense of all the site collections I have. And again, if you remembered in the UI, these are those same things that I was adding storage to, assigning a site collection owner to. It's the same list. And you can see who the owner is, and you can also see how much storage is allocated to them. The final thing that I'll show you here is, if you want to take this and actually output this to see more information, I'm going to show you one more command that shows you the different templates that we have available, and then I'll show you where you can actually get this information and export it outside of PowerShell to something that's a little bit more useful. So this next command that I'm pasting in here is actually going to get me that same list as you see above here, but with more information, and it's actually going to export it as a CSV file on my desktop, and hopefully it's going to land right about here when it gets created. So if you can see my arrow, because that's where it's been showing up. So I'm going to hit return, and this is going to get the information, wrap it into a CSV file, and you'll see here now I've got a new file that I'm going to open with Excel, and I won't spend a whole lot of time here, but you'll get an idea if I start to double click, and you'll see the information that we're actually pulling off of here. Some of it may be useful, some of it, you know, you might delete real quickly if you're generating a report to provide to somebody. But you'll see here, we're just pulling more information out of SharePoint Online and giving you it in a tool like Excel, where you can munge the data. And certainly this data you wouldn't do too much with, but imagine you're pulling a storage report or an external user report or a sites report and how much each team is using. You could do it very easily through PowerShell, dump it into Excel, and have that information at your fingertips. So those are a couple of pretty straightforward actions and more familiarizing you with what's available. The next thing I'm going to do is actually create a whole new site collection here in PowerShell. And it's a bit of a long string, but I'll walk you through what's happening here. So I'm using this new command, new SPO site, and adding the owner, which is, again, the account that I have been using to date. I'm going to apply the storage quota at 100. And here's where I'm actually going to define what it is, where I want to create it, in the sites zone. with the name Sunset at Montmanjour. And maybe take a little note here because that's one of my trivia questions. And then I want to pass through that I don't want it to wait. So I want, if I had multiple commands in a script, this is where I want it to initiate the command, but not wait for the completion. So that's what no wait means. I want to give it a resource quota of 25 so that I can do some customization. And then I'm choosing which template I'm going to apply, which is from that list of templates I just showed you. I'm going to set the time zone ID, and I'm also going to pass through this title, Sunset at Montmajour. So if I press return, if all goes well, what this is going to do is it's going to pass through a command to my SharePoint Online Admin Center to generate this new site collection. So we get the prompt. It doesn't mean that this site collection is yet finished, but it does mean that PowerShell is now ready for me to do the next thing, which is because of that no wait command. And we call that out in the lab as well. I'm going to navigate back real quickly just to show you from the site collections tab what this starts to look like, because I just generated a single new site collection. Here it is with the Ferris wheel spinning and all the ants getting dizzy. And of course, there's the title Sunset at Montmajour with 100 megabytes assigned to it. And if I clicked into it once it's finished, you would see it's got the right site owner, it's the right site template. And once this is finished, I can come back to that and show you really obviously what that looks like based on the template that I chose. So since we don't want to stop there, we actually want to see that this is something that you can do in bulk. The next thing I'm going to do is actually going to import a script, and I'll show you visually what this looks like here. So what I'm going to do is going to take this CSV file, very simple one that I've created, and I'm going to pass through an owner, storage quota, URL, effectively what the site collection name is going to be, the resource quota, the template, the time zone ID, and the name of the site. And you'll see here, if you navigate through, I'm going to create four site collections in bulk in one action based on this CSV file that currently lives on my desktop. So there's no real trickery here. And I'm going to create these four site collections: in Ignite team site, a specific blog site, a project site, and a community site. So these will get generated new today, but it's based on this script being called and then enumerating through and really passing through, with that no wait command. This is a pretty long string that I just pasted in here, but some of the same thing. This is where I'm going to import the CSV file that you now see behind here, and I'm going to import and start to run through what I want it to do. And so effectively, I want to create a new site with the owner, quota, template, on, and then enumerate through that. So again, I'm going to hit return. And we should get a command prompt relatively soon. If I didn't have that no wait command, this would take a little while for the prompt to come back because it would wait till that final site collection was generated. But again, I'm going to go back to that SharePoint Online Admin Center, the Sunset at Montmajour. And again, the error that we were seeing earlier is around provisioning. So I am provisioning new site collections. We've identified that it's specifically for upgrade. But if this is a little slow today, that might be one indication why the provisioning timing is taking a little bit longer. But usually it takes within a couple of minutes. We should at least see that they're being generated. And I have some other fallbacks that I can use to show you a few other things. But if I go in and I'm going to hit F5 to refresh the page, we should now see that there are five site collections being generated. And there's the four new ones. And actually, this one's just finished. So we now, I'll click into that to show you what got created. But now in a bulk action, we've got these four site collections being created. A quick look at what this one looks like. It's just a team site on day one. Certainly a lot of different actions you can take at the site collection level. But you'll see here through PowerShell, we created a new team site. And here is that site's Sunset at Montmajour. A lot of things I can do now from here. But let me go back and minimize this, and we'll get into some of the fun stuff. So those are some of the pretty straightforward things you can do with PowerShell. And now let me start to navigate on how we actually manage storage and start to manage people. So if I paste this in here, this next command is I'm actually going to see a list of all of the site collections that I have and the storage that they have. Again, if I wanted to export this out, I can. I'm going to skip that just for time, but I could export it the same as I did this templates folder to get this and more information into Excel. But the thing that I actually want to do is I want to go in and set a new amount of level on an existing site collection. So I'm going to paste this in and walk you through what it is I'm going to do. But from this list above, you'll see here this BI center. Right now it has a storage allocation of 1, 2, 3, 4, just for ease of identifying. And I'm going to pass through a new set command that I want to set that new storage quota at 5, 6, 7, 8. And I actually should double check before I commit to this to make sure that I have that much storage, and I do, so that this won't fail. But effectively, you're going to see this number, 1, 2, 3, 4, change to 5, 6, 7, 8, which of course is a lot more storage. And I'm going to set the new warning level at 75%. This is how I would do that in PowerShell. So I'm going to hit Command. This is going to make a change just to that site collection. And I'm going to run this same exact command that I did up here. Once it's completed, it may not return it immediately in terms of when I run the command again. But I will do that just so that we can see that more directly, so that you can see the result here. And we'll just go back to check here to see how we're doing. A couple of sites are finished already, a few being worked on. I'm going to hit F5 just to see how our BI center is doing. So we're still applying that change here. So it is still taking a little time, but you'll see the number already showing up here where it says 5, 6, 7, 8 instead of 1, 2, 3, 4. So we see it visually here. And if PowerShell is ready for us, which it's still waiting to return, and it's my bad because I didn't use the no wait command. But we'll wait. It shouldn't take too long for that to happen. I am going to jump ahead just to give you kind of a look while this is going, because I've got a number of things to move to next. But I am going to go to a site here that is a separate site collection called Hello Ignite. And I'm logged in instead of as Mark. You'll see up here I'm logged in as Katie Jordan. And a couple things I want to show you here just to familiarize. When we get to managing people and their permission level through PowerShell, we're actually going to take, since we're doing some SharePoint Online administration training for you on the phone call here, we're actually going to take Katie Jordan through SharePoint Online Administration basic training, meaning we're going to build her up and then we're going to break her down. And effectively what I mean is we're just going to give her a lot more permissions than she already has. So you'll see here, she really has very limited access. You don't see any admin here. And really what I want to draw your attention to is this gear where you usually can get to site settings of a site collection. You'll see she really doesn't have access to very much. And even if you clicked into some of these zones, they would be pretty limiting. But so keep an eye here, and then when we actually get to the site setting pages, you'll see what she then has more and more access to. So right now she's a viewer of this site. That's the level of permission that she has. And I'm actually going to pass through. Hopefully PowerShell has returned, which it has not. So let's see what's going on at the BI Center. And since we're doing lots of provisioning, it might be in a hold. So it looks like we just finished. And so PowerShell, there we go. It's now returned. So I'm going to scroll down just so we can get a kind of a fresh look here. And we're going to do a number of things to Katie Jordan. So let me load up my next cheat. So we're effectively going to first put her in a the site collection group that we've already got established here. And we're going to give her owner permissions. So we're going to add SPO user into the group Hello Ignite Owners, which of course has a lot more permissions. And we're going to apply that to KDJ, which is her login name here, on this specific site, which is the Hello Ignite site that I was just on. So when I commit to this, this should return pretty quickly because it's making a pretty small adjustment, but of course a powerful one. And now it tells me KDJ, it belongs to these two groups, both the owners group and the visitors group. So now if I go back to Katie Jordan's experience, again, I'm hitting F5 just to refresh the page. The immediate look and feel won't be too different because we haven't adjusted things on the page so much to be restricted to certain people, but you certainly can from a web parts perspective. But now when I click on this gear, you'll see that she has a lot of more actions that she can take, where she can add a page, she can actually add an app as an owner, and of course she can go into site settings. So if I go into site settings, And I'm going to come back to this page once we give her even more permissions. One of the things you don't see here is the site collection administration. It's just at this site level, restricted to a lot of things that she can do, but not necessarily everything. So I'm going to go in here and actually, through PowerShell, make her a more powerful user on the site collection, a site collection owner. And it's a lot of the same methods, but here I'm going to say, is site collection admin true? And commit to that. And again, it should return pretty quickly. It's not a new group, but it's a new level, so you don't see it listed here in the groups. But now that that's completed, if I hit refresh again on this particular site collection, you'll see now Katie Jordan has been given or delegated more permissions, and you'll see here this whole new area that is the site collection administration, which gives her access to the recycle bin to restore things that have been deleted by end users that end users don't have access to. So if a full site in this site collection was deleted, she could now go to the recycle bin and restore that. And that's true for any site collection from a recycle bin. And then I'll just pause for 2 seconds that we just announced that the recycle bin has been increased from 30 days to 90 days. So we're pretty excited about that. So now that we've given KDJ all of this great power, we're actually going to now take it away from her. And we'll do this much quickly and just commit to it instead of giving her the true statement. Now this site collection is going to go when I hit F5. So now we're taking away those permissions. And actually, we're going to remove her from the users, the group owners tab, and actually put her back as just in the viewers group. So when I get back to this is my least successful looking part of the demo, but you'll see obviously what I'm doing is the whole point. But once this returns, now when I go back here and I hit F5, you should see what you expect to see. Sorry, you don't have access to this page at all, which is unfortunate for her, but is the reality of what we just did. And so if I go in and I go back to the Ignite home, it doesn't mean that I can't access the site. It just means all those deeper levels of the site that I meant to access, I now no longer can access because I've been removed from the that owners tab. And so you can see now it's being reflected at the site level. So we've built her up and we've broken her down, and no harm to her. It's just a matter of level of access that we wanted to provide to her. So I do know that we're a little thin on time, so I want to get to the next level, which is a little bit more of how I could do that in a bulk action. So if I actually wanted to set up new groups and apply new users to those groups, I have to do one thing that I call out in the lab here, where I want to set the execution policy to bypass, just so that I can show you this. And then I'm actually going to open up a script, and I'll show you exactly what this does, and then I'll just run it. But what this is going to do is it's going to call out a PS1 file, which I have on my desktop here, which effectively is going to open up two CSV files that I have. One is the groups and permissions, and the other is the users. What the groups and permissions one does is it's actually going to say, I want to create a new group that's called Ignite Leads Today's Date, and I'm going to give them full control. And then I actually want to pump in these new users or existing users into this new group, which means I'm going to put this individual into that group we just created and on this particular site collection, which I can go to maybe a little bit later if people want to hang around and just to see what it looks like. But effectively, I'm passing through this command to go and create a new group and populate it with named users. So when I hit return, it's going to open up that PS1 file and start to run through it through each individual person for as many times as we have. And you'll see the results here are I'm giving creating a new group, and that's already applied here. So this new group now exists on this particular site, which is a site that I had already created. And then it's going to go in and make sure that those three users are added to that group. While that's chugging away, I'm going to get set here to do just a quick report so you can see what that looks like and show you what it looks like to kind of do a user report. So I first want to grab, now that it's returned, we got one more to go before it'll come back to us here. There we go. So back into PowerShell, I'm going to paste in this command, just so we can see how many people are actually on a particular site collection. So this is one that we haven't seen, but it's called Contoso Partners. And you're seeing here a result set back from all the people that have access to this site collection, including people that are external. I'll just point out here that I've invited two of my external demo accounts, this m.cashman@hotmail.com and this markshare test@yahoo.com. So I'm returning everybody, including external users. You could also do this specifically to just external users. And again, this is going to be a longer string that I'm pasting in here, so bear with me. But what it's going to do is it's going to get this same set of users. But in addition, it's also going to then generate a report pulling in users from other sites, including one of the ones that we just created, which is this Ignite project. So hopefully that's not the point of failure. But it's going to pull from this list above that you see here. Then it's going to add to another set of users from the BI Center. Then it's also going to add to another set of users from Ignite. And then hopefully you'll see that the output, the power here, is that I can then generate a report and do a number of things, because I'm writing to this same Ignite users report TXT. And then I'm telling it here a key command, which means I'm going to append it to what was already output from this above. So it's going to run it three times and keep appending it to that same file. So it's something kind of cool that you can do in terms of creating a report into the same file, not having to generate three files and then munge them together yourself. So I'm going to hit return, get that one running, and it's going to create that new file on the desktop, which we'll minimize here so we can see it. It's just going to get generated here on the back end. And this is really the last thing that I wanted to show through PowerShell. So while that's being generated, until PowerShell returns here, I'm going to just navigate to the questions and maybe just quickly identify that we're at the 10 o'clock hour. So I certainly appreciate your time. I'm probably going to go another 5 or 10 minutes with questions. I apologize that it's running over. But I certainly want to make sure that if you do have something scheduled at 10, now it is 10. And I appreciate your time for listening. My really last slide I have is a resources slide. I will also be tweeting out access to the deck so that you can view it and link into those resources as well. So I do appreciate your time. If you need to leave, I totally and completely understand. But since this returned a little bit faster than I thought, I'm going to actually navigate to where I put this. And I'm just going to navigate into my C drive. And we will see this user Ignite reports.txt that I just created. And we're going to open it with just simple Notepad for now. And you'll see here the report that was generated coming from this three site collections, a lot of information about all these users. And so if you can imagine the level of reporting that you want to do, you'll see up the top here I had set it with a little bit of different formatting. But effectively, I can output this as a CSV file into Excel, do a number of different things to generate reports on what users have access to different sites, which external users are being invited, and more the power of being able to generate reports through PowerShell. But this is the report that was just generated. I'm certainly not going to do much from here, but from the scenario of wanting to know who has access to what, and are they what levels and groups are they in, you can see that that's what this report is telling me. So Josh, I'll turn it to you just for a second. If you want to do a wrap-up close, I'll certainly turn to questions and start reviewing them while you do that, and just to make sure that hopefully I haven't missed anything significant from anything errors.
Yeah, great, Mark. Thanks so much. Awesome presentation. We didn't have too many questions, but if you do have a question that didn't get answered, please feel free, now is the time to go ahead and paste those in. And also, Vivek, do you have that link to the Jumpstart? I think that'd be great. There's some really great resources for PowerShell that people have been asking. Mark, if you have anything that you could recommend too.
You bet. Really, the next things that I was going to show are the key resources. So this lab that I've been mentioning, I've tried to make a quick, easy link that you can write down here, or again, I've tweeted it out so you can click into it. It is going to open up in the Word web app, so it's hosted on my SharePoint Online account. It's being shared out to you in an anonymous fashion, what we talked about earlier. But this quick link will take you there, and it'll be something that hopefully you'll be able to access. I'm also going to put it into the chat window here, just so you can click on it from there, maybe a little bit easier. So there you go. But it's a quick link to a guest link that will open up the document. It's a nice one to walk through, and you'll see a lot of what I showed today and more. But a lot of the resources, again, from a resourcing perspective, is the planning guide that we have for SharePoint Online is available for enterprise and for small business. I'm just identifying the enterprise one here just because it talks to a lot of what we showcased today, because you can generate multiple site collections and you're managing it through PowerShell. PowerShell is not yet enabled for the small business. It's not quite as applicable from a lot of the use case scenarios, but certainly there is a planning guide for small business as well. The console that I was using, or the PowerShell command center, we call it the SharePoint Online Management Console, and this is where you would go to actually learn more and then to actually get the tool. We also have something that I didn't show, and but it's easy one to click into. If you click this site, you'll be taken to an online hosted tool that will help you build out your own commands. We call it the SharePoint PowerShell Command Builder. It's applicable to SharePoint 2013 and SharePoint Online. And when you get there, you can choose SharePoint Online. It'll limit the types of commandlets that you have access to. And you really just plug and play a couple key pieces of information, and it gives you those scripts that I was using. They are also in the lab that I mentioned, but if you want to generate your own specific to your site collections, to your users, to, you know, a number of different things you're going to choose, this command builder will help you build the scripts that you then copy-paste just like I did into the SharePoint Online Management Console. And then finally, the lab here again called out, and these resources and more, a lot more, I was tweeting out during the session, and you'll see them all with the hashtag SPOAdmin. So hopefully you'll be able to find those, and I'll just type that real quickly here. And those will be available, again, whether you're following me or not. There's just a bunch of resources that the different teams have been putting out there, in addition to, I think, the material that Vivek was pointing to for Jumpstart, but also more specifically descriptions of the commandlets and how you work with the PowerShell. And certainly there's a lot of powerful things that you can do. The lab is a great start, the more and more you get comfortable with it. But you may be doing very basic activities. But if you're ever doing anything in bulk, I really urge you to get comfortable enough in PowerShell, because it will save you a lot of time to do things where you don't necessarily need to go to the user interface. So I'm going to start now, jump to the questions, see if I can go back to where we were. Looks like a lot of them were addressed. I want to make sure that they're...
So if you have any additional questions, now's the time. Also, just real quick, I'm going to throw up a couple survey questions, and then I'll come back to this resource page if you haven't gotten it yet.
Yeah, I'll address a couple here, but certainly I'll address all that haven't been in the chat window. The first one that just kind of caught my eye is the walk through the difference between the social components of Yammer and Newsfeed. I'll more point you to a resource that we have on the Office 365 tech blog. It's pretty easy to discover if you do blogs.office.com, and then you'll see within the list of the various blogs one that's called Office 365 tech. We actually have a lot of information coming out about Yammer in terms of either the differences between the two or a lot of the new innovation that we're bringing. But effectively, Yammer and Newsfeed, before we acquired the company Yammer, did a lot of the same actions. Yammer certainly does it outside of SharePoint in terms of where it's run and managed. It's a separate service, whereas Newsfeed is a little bit more embedded in the product because it started there. But some of the activities that we're doing are bringing it more and more into SharePoint from an integrated experience perspective. And in the Office 365 UI, you saw how we can adjust and accept that my company wants to use Yammer. And in Yammer, I can start threaded conversations where I can post documents, ideas, I can ask questions, I can do polls like what Josh is doing here, but have it be only internal to my company. I can use my network to even talk to external users. And a good example there where I'm using Yammer tomorrow with a unique SharePoint user group called SPYAM, and working with a guy named Joel Olson, who is going to have a Q&A through Yammer in an external network where it's not managed by Microsoft, it's managed by Joel and his team, and I'll be joining as an external user to their network to answer questions and to provide feedback across a number of different things in SharePoint Online. So there's a lot of things you can do in Yammer. There's a lot of things you can do in Newsfeed. A lot of the use cases we see for Newsfeed are if you're not willing to adopt the cloud just yet, you can use SharePoint on-premises with Yammer, you know, as a service, with the Newsfeed as a service running on-premises, and you'll get a lot of the same capabilities to be able to post information you're working on, ask questions, reach out to different users by at mentioning them, using hashtags, posting documents. Some of the same capabilities, but more of as a feature of SharePoint, not as a more robust separate service like Yammer is. So that's kind of the higher level, not so much what are the differences of, but maybe where they run and some of the use cases for them. But for more information, it's really, we hope it's easy to find. If not, you can always reach to me through Twitter or through my email, which is the same mcashman@microsoft.com. And I can point you to the right locations of information. There's one question around how can I activate, deactivate sharing for external per user? A lot of that is more of managing permissions. So from an admin perspective, you would, of course, first give the capabilities to do external sharing. And then you would then enable at a site collection level for people to be able to invite external users. Once they've been invited, it doesn't mean that they then can't be taken away. And you would go in, same as I was giving KDJ more and more permissions, I could actually remove her as a user from that site collection altogether. Then she has no access to that site. And once you have that entity of an external user in a site collection, from an Active Directory or an authentications perspective, they're just another object that you can then give or take away permissions, and that may be various levels or access all the way. So you could do that certainly through PowerShell. You could also navigate to the site collection, go to permissions and groups, and then take that user out of there, and then they would have no longer have access as an external user. They already have limited access of what they can do that's a little bit different than what I showed KDJ's access to, and we did a whole session on that. If you want to search and find external sharing end-to-end, that was another session that we did through Ignite. And it walks through from an end user, what does it look like? What does the invitations look like? What does it look like to manage those users as well? In site collections there, okay, we're talking about external sharing again. Yeah, when you get to sharing anything in SharePoint, there's a button at the very top of almost every site collection or team site or portal that says share. When you click share, the sharing dialog box will open. You input somebody's email address, that could be external, internal, and then it'll route them through the acceptance process. And effectively, from an admin perspective, it makes them an object in SharePoint that we then can manage and control. But that's a button in the upper left called Share that will start that sharing wizard for end users to go in and invite or to request to invite, depending on the level of permissions that they have. Let's see. I know that we're whittling down on those that are staying on, but just noticing that there are still a few people here. If there's something that I'm missing, it might be helpful if you can just say again that I've asked a question and maybe identify the what your name was, and I can scroll up to it if I'm not getting to it. If you go, there was a question on subscribing to the technology blog. So it looks like Dean answered that. You can go to the blog that Dean Gross pointed out at about 9:54 today. Once you go there, in the upper right, just like any other website or blog, you can see that you can subscribe to an RSS feed. And to be honest, I do that so that I'm familiar with what the other teams are doing. And you know, I as an example, we upped the limits for SkyDrive Pro to 25 gigs. And the next day, the Exchange Online team actually announced that they up-leveled the inbox sizes for each mailbox from 25 gigs to 50 gigs. In my article, I had posted that the overall storage that you get in SharePoint in Office 365 was inclusive, of course, of that mailbox count, and I had initially listed it as 25 gigs. I had subscribed to the tech blog. I saw that they upped from 25 to 50. And right away, I went and updated my blog so that I was having the right level of information. And certainly, in this new cadence, we're bringing a lot of new technology, trying to be as transparent as possible as far as when they land, the what it is, how you can use it, and certainly any known issues, calling that up. And that blog is a great place to see and get a sense of a lot of the new activity, new things that we're bringing, especially if you're not on Office 365 yet, really seeing the amount of innovation that we're bringing there. Differences between Windows Azure Active Directory module for Windows PowerShell and PowerShell. This is probably one I couldn't address most directly, but I do want to say that what I have here on the slide, which is the management console here called out, that is just a console that's built on top of PowerShell. So you have to have PowerShell installed to then install the management console that will allow you to talk effectively to SharePoint Online, your tenant. But it wouldn't run without that. I believe if you're doing activities against Active Directory for Windows Azure, you would have to have that unique console that gives you kind of the tools already to talk effectively through to Azure Active Directory because of what you can and can't do there. But really, it's just more of to give you the layer so that you can do it. Let's see. Module in your start. Looks like a lot of people were addressing that. Certainly there's a lot of information about PowerShell. Let's see. Looks like Garrett is answering. So can you give a high level about Power BI and how it's used? So I'll do my best here. Certainly Power BI is a new offering that is in preview right now, and it really enables you to do a lot more of the higher end BI capabilities that weren't yet available, like Power Pivot, Power View, the new Power Map that we have available. Really just to run those in SharePoint Online is really a part of Power BI. Another thing that you can do with Power BI is to connect to external data sources. So if you imagine you're doing and using our enterprise feature called Excel Services, and you're using that just inside SharePoint Online, you can do a lot of powerful things to up-level and create dashboards and reports right in the UI of SharePoint Online. But the data source up to this date has had to have been with inside SharePoint Online. With Power BI, you can connect to external data sources that could live in SQL servers on premises. They could be hosted in other instances of SQL Azure. You could also have it be a data source in Oracle. You know, we don't necessarily care what the data source is, but what we're enabling you to do is to then connect your experience or your end user access, which is SharePoint, SharePoint Online, to pass through and pull in that data so that it's the experience is not having to then give everybody access to Oracle, SQL, or some of those back-end systems, but to be able to create those dashboards or powerful workbooks that then people can access through the web. And another aspect of Power BI that they announced was a Windows 8 app, which then gives you that same access, but from an app perspective, to be able to navigate the graph or data information that's coming out of Excel. So encourage you to try it. It's definitely in preview right now. There's a lot to it in terms of what you can and can't do. It's a lot of opening up doors that have not been possible, where if you ask me, the level of BI that we supported in SharePoint Online up to this point, before Power BI, was about 40% of the power of SharePoint in terms of historically and now certainly with SharePoint 2013. And with Power BI, we're really bringing that up to about 80 or 90% of the capabilities, with a key thing of being able to connect to external data sources. So it's a big advancement for us. We think it's going to be a huge offering to customers that have those requirements, and it is not lightweight BI. It is, as it sounds, pretty rich, capable BI, and certainly we hope the name reflects it, but you got to try it yourself. It's available. Shouldn't be too hard to find to get started to create a new tenant that has the Power BI capabilities in a preview sense. And if you have trouble finding it, again, ping me and I can point you in the right direction. Let's see. Office integration. So we're just getting some suggestions for future presentations. It looks like it covered a lot of the questions that were open. Certainly, if you've got more feedback, you can either channel them through the Ignite channel. Josh is always available to get good ideas around future sessions. If there are ones that I can support or find the right people to support, I will absolutely do that. This is our third one, and it's been really helpful to us to be able to share more and get a lot of the feedback where people are having questions or concerns so we can make it easier to find the material or generate new material, certainly to do that. But certainly, if you have questions or feedback, don't hesitate to reach out to me or through the channels that you know in terms of forums. There's a great one, the Office 365 community, that is available anytime 24/7 with a staff of our support team that are answering questions. When you're using the service, you have access to support to either open a service request or to start up a new forum thread that's not just community. There's a lot of Microsoft people, including a V team that I'm a part of, that reviews that. So definitely don't hesitate to reach out. If you're having trouble finding where those channels are, reach out to the easy one, which is just me or Josh, and we'll point you in the right direction. There is one last question from Kevin Miller. Will the 5,000 item limit for libraries be increased soon? It definitely is getting a lot of traction. I don't have anything to disclose today, but I can tell you it's in the front of the right team looking at the 5,000 limit, which is really just a view limit. It's not a limit of how many items you can put in a library or put into a list. It is a limit of either the amount of items that we can do in a single view. So you can do a lot of unique things with metadata, or just a way to limit the first view that somebody sees before they page to the next page. There's also an issue around syncing, which is, I believe, more what you're asking. So if I'm using the SkyDrive Pro Sync client, which we have for Windows, and syncing across items coming from either my SkyDrive Pro library or from a team-side document library, which uses that same sync client, today there is a limit of an item count, which again, you can limit in terms of how many items you have there. In a team site, you can allocate them across multiple document libraries in the same site collection. And we do have best practices out there from management and a control of those, to where you want to do that at a team level. And I absolutely will tell you that it's very clear feedback that we've already gotten. And the SkyDrive Pro team is very much looking at how they can get beyond that limit, both from a sync client perspective, but also from the sync protocol, where we want to first not only enable it, but enable it so that it's a good, consistent experience, so that it does sync those. But the limit is 20,000 for SkyDrive Pro and 5,000 for team site document libraries from a sync perspective. So hopefully that gives you a little context. I will just at least tell you or retell you, we've gotten a lot of that feedback, and the teams are hard at work looking to see how we can increase those numbers. And they're doing a lot of work just to see the telemetry data, where it doesn't reveal the who. There's no PII being discovered, but really just usage patterns. How many people are pushing that? Is that 1% of the population? Is it 50%? And those things help us not so much do we do it or not, but how we prioritize it. And certainly more feedback like today, it helps to up-level that those are concerns or issues that people are looking into, hopefully not blocked by it, but if they are, we are getting that feedback.
Okay, great. Thanks, Mark. I think we have just one last question from Andy about is it possible to set Masterpage online with Posh? And then I'll also just say real quick before we end the call, thanks for joining. And our next webcast is a week from today, same time, same place. You can find the links again. I keep posting it, but I'll just do it one last time. But yeah, I guess if we can address this last question, that'd be great.
Yep. So the question is, if I have a custom master page that I want to apply to multiple site collections, either at creation or once they've been created, and unfortunately, the answer today is no. It is a scenario that we've put forth, already as feedback to the team. Some of the issues are, where do you first store that? And since we're moving away from storing a custom template in SharePoint Online, doesn't mean you can't do it, but we're moving into where you can move that more as a custom app that's stored and managed from how you get it and move it into. You certainly could build a custom solution to be able to do that, because you saw I was able to apply a specific template, but the template first needs to be available in at the tenant level so that all site collections could have access to it. And right now we don't have a zone for that where you could do that programmatically across multiple site collections. But if you posted it as a custom solution, aka a custom site template as an app, you could then do that similar workflow that I saw, where you could go and get an app and apply it to a site or a site collection and have that template available, and then certainly apply it. So it is an area where we are investigating. It is not an area that we've cracked, especially when you go to apply it to multiple site collections, if you use what we have out of the box. I do know that there are some custom solutions that I can't promote nor support from a Microsoft has certified perspective, but they are using what we call the CSOM, which is the object, using the object model from a developer's perspective. You could build out a lot of unique solutions, and Microsoft IT has created a lot of unique solutions for the different business units here at Microsoft, and they're doing it in SharePoint Online, they're hosting the solutions in Azure, and they're pretty robust, very integrated type solutions, one of them being just the awareness of the type of information that's allowed on a certain site from a governance perspective. So they built a custom solution that would promote some alerts using our alert system that's already there to tap into that and to provide context back to users around the different types of sites and what you can do there and what's allowed by Microsoft policy. So there's a lot of things you can do around an app perspective. I'm by no means a deep subject matter expert there, but there would be ways to accomplish what you're looking to do through a custom solution, but not yet out of the box with tools that we have. So we're way over. I certainly appreciate the last 40 of you that are hanging on there. There's a lot of information out there. There's a lot of people to help out there, both in a real-time setting if you're an existing customer, if you're looking for more information or wanting to get onto the service soon. We've got a lot of material out there to help you onboard, to help you plan, to help you execute, and then certainly once on the system to make sure things are running smoothly. There's a whole team that's there to keep you up and running in SharePoint Online. And there's a lot of learning you can do, to make those right decisions. So thank you. Have a great day. Have a great night. And thanks for joining.